Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles will be provided in the description and also in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now, before going to the segment of articles discussion, let us proceed to the discussion on previous year questions that were asked in Prelims 2020. Now see this question with reference to Vithal Vidvansak. The question reads, the Vithal Vidvansak, the first monthly journal to have the untouchable people as its target audience, was published by. See, the correct answer for this question is option A, Gopal Baba Walankar. See, Gopal Baba Walankar was an activist who worked to release the people who were tagged as untouchable from their historic socio-economic oppression. He was born in 1840 in Maharashtra. It is reported that he belonged to a particular caste that was at that time considered or tagged as untouchable. Later, Gopal Baba became influenced by another early social reformer who is Jyotirao Phule. And we have to note that he was given membership of the municipal body at Mahad in the year 1884. Later, in 1888, he began publishing a monthly journal titled as Vithal Vidvansak. The meaning of this term is destroyer of Brahmanical pollution or destroyer of ceremonial pollution. It is this journal that was the first to have people who were tagged as untouchable as its target audience. In addition to this, he is also noted for writing articles for Marathi language newspapers like Sudharak and Deen Bandhu. So the correct answer is option A, Gopal Baba. Now see this another question from the segment of history. The question reads, with reference to scholars or literatures of ancient India, consider the following statements. Panini is associated with Pushyamitra Shunga, Amarasimha is associated with Harshavardhana, Kalidasa is associated with Chandragupta too. They are asking which of the statements given above are correct. If you take Panini, he was a legendary Indian grammarian who was a noted pupil of Takshashila in ancient India. See, Takshashila in ancient India became famous as a place of learning because of the expertise of its teachers. And Panini is one of its noted pupil. He was an expert in language and grammar and authored one of the greatest works on Sanskrit grammar, which is called as Ashtadhyayi. His period is around 500 before Common Era, BCE. But if you take Pushyamitra Shunga, he ruled in 2nd century BCE. That is from 200 BCE to 101 BCE. So there is a clear mismatch here. So the first statement is incorrect. The second statement talks about Amarasimha. See, Chandragupta II of Gupta dynasty ruled during 375 CE to 415 Common Era. He was known for his deep interest in art and culture and also known for the nine gems or Navaratna who adorned his court. Amarasimha was one of the nine gems. Others included Danvantari, Harisena, Kalidasa, Kahapanaka. So they were some of the nine gems. If you take Amarasimha, he was a Sanskrit grammarian and poet who is known for his work Amarakosha. So his period we could see during the Chandragupta II period. But if you take King Harshavardhana, he lived during 7th century Common Era. Therefore, statement 2 is also incorrect. There is a mismatch. Now coming to Kalidasa and the third statement, Kalidasa was the greatest and most famous poet of Gupta period who ruled during the time of Chandragupta II. He wrote Abhijnana Shakuntalam, Raghuvansam, Meghadutha and Kumara Sambhava. Therefore, here statement 3 is correct. So the correct answer for this question is option C, 3 only. See this question with reference to preamble. The preamble to the Constitution of India is a part of the Constitution but has no legal effect. Not a part of the Constitution and has no legal effect either. A part of the Constitution and has the same legal effect as any other part. Then a part of the Constitution but has no legal effect independently of other part. See, the correct answer for this question is option D. It is a part of the Constitution but has no legal effect independently of other part. See, preamble is an introductory statement which states the aims and objectives of the Constitution. One of the controversies about the preamble was whether it is a part of the Constitution or not. In the Berubari Union case of 1960, The apex court specifically opined that preamble is not a part of the constitution. However, in 1973, in the case of Nanda Bharti case, the Supreme Court rejected its earlier opinion and it held that preamble is a part of the constitution. It observed that preamble is of extreme importance and that the constitution should be read and interpreted in the light of the grand and noble vision which is expressed in the preamble. Again, in the LIC of India case in 1995, Supreme Court once again held that preamble is an integral part of the constitution. So currently, according to Supreme Court of India judgments, the preamble is a part of the constitution. However, it is non-justiciable. That is, its provisions are not enforceable in courts of law. That is, if you find something in the preamble is violated, you cannot go to the court of law to enforce it. That is why the correct answer is option D. It is a part of the constitution but has no legal effect independently of other part. On one hand, if you take fundamental rights, it is enforceable and justiciable, whereas preamble is not justiciable. That is why option C is incorrect. Now see this next question with reference to welfare state. Which part of the constitution of India declares the ideals of welfare state? Directive principles of state policy, fundamental rights, preamble, 7th schedule. See, it's a straightforward question. The answer is directive principles of state policy. See, DPSP aims to create social and economic conditions under which citizens can lead a good life. They also aim to establish social democracy, economic and political democracy through a welfare state. Under part 4 of Indian Constitution belong to this section called as directive principles of state policy, of which Article 38 states that state should secure a social order for the promotion of welfare of the people. So the correct answer is option A, directive principles of state policy. Now this concept of having directive principles of state policy in constitution is borrowed from the constitution of Ireland. See, in November 1944 at New Delhi, a standing committee of non-party conference met and adopted a resolution to appoint a committee with Sir Tej Bahadur Sapru as its head. This Sapru committee in 1945 in its report suggested two categories of individual rights, one being justiciable and other being non-justiciable rights. See, the justiciable rights, as we know, are the fundamental rights, whereas the non-justiciable ones are the directive principles of state policy. So DPSP are ideals which are meant to be kept in mind by the state when it formulates policies and when it enacts legislations. So they are ideals that are not legally enforceable by the courts for their violation, unlike fundamental rights. And note that Indian Constitution has not originally classified the directive principles. However, on the basis of the content and direction, they are usually classified into socialistic, Gandhian and liberal intellectual principles. So the correct answer is option A, DPSP. With this, let's move on to the news articles discussion. So this news article is about issues arising because of the amendments that were made to Foreign Contribution Regulation Act 2010. In this context, let us learn about FCRA 2010, amendments made to it and the challenges arising because of the new changes, mainly to the civil society organizations and non-government organizations. Even yesterday, there was a news article related to this issue, particularly with reference to the amendments made to the FCRA 2010. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. See, the Foreign Contribution Regulation Amendment Bill 2020 was introduced in Lok Sabha on September 20, 2020. Within 8 days, the bill was passed by both the houses of the parliament and it received the assent of the president on September 28, 2020. Now let us see the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act 2010 and how certain changes were imposed on it by the Amendment Act of 2020. See, Foreign Contribution Regulation Act regulates the acceptance and utilization of foreign contribution by individuals, associations and companies in India. Foreign contribution is the donation or transfer of any foreign currency or security or article given by a foreign source. Usually the value will be beyond a particular specified value. That is, not everything that comes from foreign source is a foreign contribution for the purposes of this act. Now let us see the provisions of the act and amendments made to it. First provision is about prohibition to accept foreign contributions. See, under the 2010 act, certain persons were prohibited to accept any foreign contribution. Among others, this included election candidates, editor or publisher of a newspaper, judges, members of legislature and political parties. Now, the Amendment Act added public servants as defined under the Indian Penal Code to this list. See, public servant includes any person who is in the service of the government or who receives pay of the government or who is remunerated by the government for the performance of any public duty. Now, the next provision is about transfer of foreign contribution. See, under the Principal Act, foreign contribution cannot be transferred to any other person unless such person is also registered to accept the foreign contribution, or such person should have obtained prior permission under the Act to obtain foreign contribution. Now, the Amendment Act amended this to prohibit the transfer of foreign contribution to any other person. The term person under the Act includes an individual or an association or a registered company. Now, the next one is about Aadhaar for registration. See, the 2010 Act states that a person may accept foreign contribution if they have obtained a certificate of registration from the central government. Then, in case they are not registered, they may accept foreign contribution if they have obtained prior permission from the central government to accept foreign contribution. And any person seeking registration or renewal of such registration or prior permission must make an application to the central government in the prescribed manner. But the Amendment Act added that any person seeking prior permission, registration or renewal of registration must provide the Aadhaar number of all its office bearers, directors or key functionaries as an identification document. If this includes a foreigner, they must provide a copy of the passport or the overseas citizen of India card for the purposes of identification. Now let's come to FCRA account provision, which is considered as a major roadblock for most of the civil society organizations. See, the Act earlier stated that a registered person must accept foreign contributions only in a single branch of a scheduled bank specified as per the Act. However, they may open more accounts in other banks for the utilization of the received contribution. But the Amendment Act amended this to state that foreign contribution must be received only in an account that is designated by the bank as FCRA account. And this account should be in such branch of the State Bank of India, New Delhi, as notified by the central government. Now, if you take the news article, it states that NGOs are reporting that making it compulsory to open a bank account in Delhi is acting as an impediment in receiving foreign contribution and their associated works, or the associated civil society works. Now, coming to the discussion, in the account that is designated as FCRA account, no funds other than the foreign contribution should be received or deposited. And for the purpose of utilizing the received contribution, a person may also open another FCRA account in any of the scheduled bank of her or his choice. Now, the next amendment is about restriction in utilization of foreign contribution. See, before amendment, if a person accepting foreign contribution is found guilty of violating any provisions of the Act, then the unutilized or unreceived foreign contribution may be received and utilized, but only with the prior approval of the central government. But the Amendment Act added that the government may also restrict usage of unutilized foreign contribution for persons who have been already granted prior permission to receive such contribution. But when this may be done? This may be done if on the basis of a summary inquiry, or if any inquiry is pending, even at that point, if the government believes that such person has contravened the provisions of the Act, then there can be restriction. The next amendment is with reference to renewal of license. See, before amendment, every person who has been given a certificate of registration must renew the certificate within a period of 6 months from expiration. But the Amendment Act provided that the government may conduct an inquiry before renewing the certificate to ensure that the person making the application is not a binami, not fictitious, has not been prosecuted or convicted for creating communal tension or for indulging in activities aimed at religious conversion, and the person has not been found guilty of diversion of funds or misutilization of funds, among the other conditions. See, the Amendment Act clearly states that before renewing the certificate, during the inquiry, the central government has to satisfy itself that the person has fulfilled all conditions specified in subsection 4 of section 12. So some of these conditions can be easily misinterpreted, or they have a wider scope, or they are lacking clarity. Next, let us see about reduction in the use of foreign contribution for administrative purposes. See, under the Act, a person who receives foreign contribution must use it only for the purpose for which the contribution is received. Earlier, it stated that they must not use more than 50% of the contribution for meeting administrative expenses. But the Amendment Act reduced this limit to just 20%. See, this received wide criticism because the intent of making this amendment is that there were some agencies, some organizations that were misusing the provisions of FCRA Act. However, by the amendment, the whole gamut of civil society organizations are now undergoing trouble because of this provision. Next, let us talk about suspension of registration. Earlier, the Act said that the government may suspend the registration of a person for a period not exceeding 180 days. But the Amendment Act added that such suspension may be expanded to an additional 180 days. So far, we saw about the provisions of the Act before amendment and the changes made to the law. Now, let us learn about the challenges that arises because of the changes. See, according to the Act, the foreign contribution must be received only in an account that is designated by the bank as FCRA account. And this designated FCRA account must be opened in branch of State Bank of India at New Delhi. News article states that this branch is SBI branch at Parliament Street in Delhi. See, this is the account wherein only the contribution should be received. Now, this provision has severely crippled the working of the non-government organizations. So, there were a lot of procedures even to undertake at the minuscule level in the appropriate regions or areas. See, we are in the midst of pandemic, so there are a lot of administrative delays on the part of banks also to adhere to the provisions related to FCRA regulations. However, without opening an FCRA account, NGOs cannot receive contributions. That severely affects their functioning. See, there was allegation that there were delays on the parts of banks to open appropriate accounts for the acceptance and utilization of foreign contribution. And according to the Act, any person seeking prior permission, registration or renewal of registration must to provide Aadhaar number of all its office bearers, directors or key functionaries as an identification document. Now, this has also created severe inconvenience for the civil society organizations. Again, with the ongoing pandemic, most of the government machinery are working with reduced staff. There are also lockdowns in many states. So, it is not easy to obtain and submit the documents that are required for prior permission, registration or renewal of registration. This again has severely impacted the functioning of non-government organizations. While this is a point that can be easily countered with the measures of Digital India, the concern is that there were a lot of procedures associated with the giving of details in the prescribed format. Earlier, there were less number of documents that have to be submitted. But now, to seek prior permission and registration and renewal, a lot of documentary work have to be done to get approval. The 2020 Amendment Act also enhances the government power in regulating and restricting the functioning of NGOs in India. There have been instances where this power has been misused as a means to target those who speak against the government or share opinion against the government policy, etc. This has also curtailed the ease of doing business for civil society organizations. So, these are some of the important points with reference to the analysis of this news article. In this analysis, we saw how was the provisions prior to the amendment and what were the changes made and how they affect the functioning of non-government organizations or civil society organizations. Now, let's move on to the analysis of next news article. So this news article is with respect to Hakki Pikki tribal community who are living in Karnataka. The article talks about the survival of people from this community who have suffered from COVID-19 infection. In this context, let us discuss in detail about tribal communities, constitutional articles related to them, and we will see finally the tribal communities in the state of Karnataka. The relevant syllabus is highlighted here for your reference. See, in Constitution of India, Article 366-25 gives a definition for the term scheduled tribes. It means such tribes or tribal communities as deemed under Article 342 of the Constitution to be scheduled tribes. See, Article 342 states that the President may, with respect to any state, after consultation with the Governor, specify the tribes or tribal communities or parts of or groups within tribes or tribal communities which shall, for the purpose of this Constitution, be deemed to be scheduled tribes in relation to that particular state. And this specification, after the consultation with the Governor, shall be made through a public notification. Also, for the Union Territory, it is the President who specifies the tribes or the tribal communities deemed to be scheduled tribes in relation to that particular Union Territory. The article further states that Parliament may, by law, include in or exclude from the list of scheduled tribes specified in such notification, that is the notification that was issued by the President, wherein we can include or exclude any tribe or tribal community or part of or group within any tribe or tribal community. Clause 2 of the article clearly states that the notification issued under Clause 1 or the notification issued by the President first shall not be varied by any subsequent notification. That is, it shall not be varied by any subsequent notification from the office of the President. So what does this mean? See, the first specification of scheduled tribes in relation to a particular state or union territory is done through a public notification by the President after consultation with the concerned state governments. That is done through the consultation with the governor. These orders can be modified subsequently. However, modification can be done only through an act of Parliament and not by the President. Know that the Constitution is silent about the criteria for specification of a community as a scheduled tribe. So tribes or tribal communities, they have to be understood in terms of their historical background of backwardness, primitiveness, geographical isolation, shyness, social, educational and economic backwardness. So these are the reasons or traits that distinguish scheduled tribe communities from other communities. See, Article 342 provides for listing of scheduled tribes state or union territory wise and not on all India basis. Now, this essentially means that the list of scheduled tribes is state or union territory specific. Therefore, a community declared as a scheduled tribe in one state need not be so in another state. Now, as per the latest updates, there are over 700 tribes who have been notified under Article 342. They are spread over different states and union territories. The largest number of main tribal communities have been specified in the state of Odisha. Note that scheduled tribes have been specified in relation to all the states and union territories except Haryana, Punjab, Chandigarh, Delhi and Pondicherry. Now come to Karnataka. Here, as per 2011 census, there are nearly 43 lakh people who are coming under the category of scheduled tribes. Now this forms roughly 7% of the total population of Karnataka. Some of the important tribal communities we can see: Siddhi community, Toda, Paniyan, Valmiki, then Koraga, Kattunayakan, then Hakipiki, Irular, Chenchu. So these are some of the important tribal communities in the state of Karnataka. And as of now, there are two particularly vulnerable tribal groups in this state. They are Jenu Kuruba and Koraga community. Finally, let us see very briefly about this Hakipiki tribe. See, they are a semi-nomadic tribe. They are one of the major tribal communities in Karnataka. In Kannada, the word Haki stands for bird. Piki stands for verb to catch. So therefore, the community, you know, is translated as bird catchers. Bird catching is their traditional occupation of this particular community. So this is about this particular tribal community. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. In this analysis, we discussed about Article 342, how the listing of scheduled tribes is done, whether it is nationally done or it is done state or UT specific. Then we discussed with reference to Karnataka and saw few information about Hakipiki tribe in the state of Karnataka. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. Now, this news article highlights the past experience of India in managing national level crisis. The author takes note of the experience as a lesson to address the current health crisis that we are facing today. In addition to this, the article specially mentions the period of Green Revolution as a time when India was the focus of global attention, just like the present scenario. So before going to the article, first let us discuss the Green Revolution. See, during the colonial rule under the British, there was neither growth nor equity in the agricultural sector. At the time of independence, about 75 to 80% of India's population was dependent on agriculture. Therefore, the policymakers of independent India had to address a range of issues in this sector, which they did actually through land reforms, then by promoting the use of high-yielding variety seeds and through other measures. The use of high-yielding variety seeds actually ushered a revolution in Indian agriculture. See, in the mid-1960s, there were two consecutive years of drought. and this resulted in a severe shortage of food. And since already the productivity of agricultural sector is low, the droughts forced India to import food from the United States of America. See, actually India was reluctant in asking for assistance because India did not support the United States during the Cold War. At this point of time, though the US exported food grains to India, India was humiliated by the delay at the time of delivery of food. This was often said as ship-to-mouth existence. So this made the political leadership at that time to realize the need for increasing the domestic production of food grains in India. And therefore, Green Revolution was adopted to ensure self-reliance in that particular segment. See, Green Revolution was an endeavor initiated by Norman Borlaug in India by Sri M.S. Swaminathan. See, the stagnation in agriculture during colonial rule was permanently broken by the Green Revolution. That is a significant success of this movement. So this refers to large increase in production of food grains, which resulted from use of high-yielding variety seeds, particularly for wheat and rice. Note that the farmers who could benefit from high-yielding variety seeds, they required reliable irrigation facilities and also financial resources so as to purchase fertilizers and pesticides. Therefore, in the first phase of Green Revolution, the use of high-yielding variety seeds was restricted to the more affluent states like Punjab, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu. See, the first phase of revolution was approximately in mid-1960s up to mid-70s. Then during this phase, the use of high-yielding variety seeds primarily benefited the wheat-growing regions only. Now coming to the second phase of Green Revolution, which is from mid-1970s to mid-1980s, the high-yield variety technology spread to a larger number of states and benefited more variety of crops. See, this led to the spread of Green Revolution technology and it enabled India to achieve self-sufficiency in food grains. So with this achievement, we no longer had to be at the mercy of America or at the mercy of any other nation for meeting our nation's food requirements. But know that there was a negative that was associated with the Green Revolution. See, because of imbalanced use of chemical fertilizers, which coupled with decrease in the use of organic manure and over-exploitation of groundwater, there was deterioration of natural resources. Also, there was little or no effort to educate farmers about the high risk that was associated with the intensive use of pesticides. See, pesticides were sprayed on crops by untrained farm laborers, mostly without following prescriptions, instructions, and precautions. And this caused more harm than good to crops, and it also became a cause for environment and soil pollution. Ultimately, they also affected the productivity and ecosystem services. So now let's come back to the article wherein the author draws lessons from the Green Revolution and states that the Green Revolution stands out in Indian history as a display of extraordinary accountability by the political leadership. It led to the decline in the rate of poverty and hunger, at the same time achieving the objective of self-reliance. According to the author, this virtue of resolve, humility and intelligence in the leadership is currently missing while addressing the present health crisis. Constructively, we can say that the leadership and their work has to be as similar or even better than the leadership that performed the Green Revolution. Then the article compares the present situation to that of 1960s when poverty and hunger struck India. See, if you take the present, India has something that it lacked in the mid-60s. See, at that time, India did not have the industrial power muscles and considerable foreign exchange reserve, which we have now. Therefore, presently, it should not be too difficult to ramp up hospital beds, ventilators or oxygen supply within a reasonable time. Also, some crucial medical imports can be imported because of availability of considerable amount of foreign reserves that India holds currently. Next, the article highlights that on an average, the states spend only around 5% of their total expenditure on health. And as we know, there is interstate variation in the death rate in the country. And this variation in death rate is directly related to the variation in health spending in relation to state domestic product. So how to avert a health crisis in the future? See, the states would have to raise the level of spending on health substantially. Along with this measure, wherein we are focusing on increasing health expenditure so as to prevent medical device shortages, we should also avoid or we should also work to prevent food shortage. Therefore, the article concludes that as the Kharif operations are set to commence, the Prime Minister needs to interact closely with the state leaders and with the farming community so that there should not be a food shortage. So these are some of the important information with reference to the analysis of this news article, wherein we discussed about Green Revolution, what was available at that time and how we tackled the then challenges, and what is the current crisis and what is the advantage that we possess today which was not available at that days in 1960s, and how to tackle the current scenario or the current crisis. Now let's move on to next news article. This news article states that the Southeast Asian country Laos has recorded its first death because of COVID-19. Therefore, the nation has lost its place among few countries that are yet to suffer a death or fatality out of COVID-19 infection. See, since the pandemic began, Laos has till now identified only 1,302 infections. In relation to this, let us discuss in brief about the nation, its geography, history and few other information. See, Laos is a landlocked country that is located in northeast central mainland of Southeast Asia. It consists of an irregularly round portion in the north, and this portion narrows down into southeast. Its capital is Vientiane, that is located on the Mekong River in the northern portion of the country. See, Laos is bounded to the north by China. In the northeast, we can see Vietnam. Vietnam is also in the east. Then to the south, we can see Cambodia. In the west, we can see Thailand. To the northwest, it is bounded by Myanmar. See, the modern-day Laos has its roots in the ancient Lao kingdom of Lan Xang, which was established in the 14th century under the king Pha Gum. For 300 years, Lan Xang had influence reaching into present-day Cambodia and Thailand, and also over the current Lao territory. After centuries of gradual decline, Laos came under domination of Thailand or Siam. This was from the late 18th century until the late 19th century. In the late 19th century, it became part of French Indochina. See, the term Indochina or French Indochina, it refers to three countries, which are Vietnam, Laos and Cambodia, that were formerly associated with France. First, they were part of French Empire, and later they were part of French Union. The term Indochina refers to the intermingling of Indian and Chinese influences in the culture of this region. Know that the Franco-Siamese Treaty of 1907 defined the current Lao border with Thailand. In 1975, the communist leader Pathet Lao took control of this government and thereby ended 6-century-old monarchy. He instituted a strict socialist regime closely aligned with Vietnam. A gradual limited return to private enterprise and liberalization of foreign investment laws, they began in 1988. And Laos became a member of ASEAN in 1997 and it became a member in World Trade Organization in 2013. Now let's see some information about India-Laos relations. See, India has enjoyed long-standing, friendly and mutually supportive relations with Laos People's Democratic Republic. Diplomatic relations between both countries were established in 1956. If you come to defense relations, Indian Army training team conducts training for Lao defense personnel in English, computers and basic tactics since the year 1994 under an agreement called as Indian Technical and Economic Cooperation Agreement. See, other than Vietnam and China, it is Indian team which is the only other foreign training team in this regard. Many important projects in Laos have been supported through Indian lines of credit over past 10 to 15 years. Examples we can say, $10 million line of credit for 115 kilowatt transmission line in the country. Then a $33 million line of credit for rural electrification, transmission line and hydropower project and few other measures. Have a look at this figure to know more about India-Laos trade relations over the past few years. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article wherein we discussed in detail about Laos and we saw few facts related to India-Laos relations. Now let us move on to next part of the discussion. This news article states that nearly 16 faculty members, other employees and retired teachers who are living in the vicinity of Aligarh Muslim University campus have died out of COVID-19 infection. In addition, the university has written to ICMR asking for an analysis of samples so as to find out what was behind the surge in the deaths and also in the infection. In this context, let us discuss about Aligarh Muslim University, which for our syllabus is covered in Indian history and also in GS1 part of main syllabus of UPSC. See, this university, it grew out of work of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. Syed Ahmad Khan was the reformer and statesman who felt that it was important for Muslims to gain education and also to become involved in the public life and in government services in India. In 1842, British decided to replace the use of Persian language for government employment also as the language of courts of law. This caused deep anxiety among Muslims in the region. However, Sir Syed saw a need for Muslims to acquire proficiency in the English language and in Western sciences. He thought that Western education was imperative or necessary if the community were to maintain its social and political clout in Northern India. Therefore, as a result of this, in the year 1877, Sir Syed founded the Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College in Aligarh. He patterned this college after Oxford and Cambridge universities, which he earlier visited on a trip to England. Note that his objective was to build a college in tune with British education system, but without compromising its Islamic values. And it was one of the first purely residential education institutions set up in India. And over the years, this gave rise to a new educated class of Indian Muslims who were active in the political system of the British Raj. See, with respect to the history associated with this college, in the year 1920, it was transformed into university called as Aligarh Muslim University. With respect to establishing this college in 1877, to Sir Syed, another person has also helped, who is Raja Jai Kishan. Both the leaders remained as friends and they represented Hindu-Muslim unity. Now coming to the article, the public relations officer of AMU added that in order to analyze the severity of COVID-19 and its suspected new variant, samples have been collected and they have been sent for viral genome sequencing to the Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology. Now let us see in brief about this particular institute, which is a premier institute of CSIR or the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. See, it is engaged in research of national importance in the areas of genomics, molecular medicine, bioinformatics and proteomics. Proteomics is the study of proteins. Note that its mission is to translate concepts developed in basic biological research into commercially viable technologies for healthcare. Now, this institute is special because it is this institute which implements the Indigen program. And as we know, the Indigen program aims to undertake whole genome sequencing of thousands of individuals representing diverse ethnic groups in our country. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. In this analysis, we saw about Aligarh Muslim University and the history associated with it and the contribution of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, role of Raja Jai Kishan. We saw about Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, which is a premier institute of CSIR. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. This news article states that the Delhi High Court has ordered to the Delhi State Legal Service Authority to provide compensation to the dependents of an accused who died under judicial custody. Why we are worried with persons dying under judicial custody or police custody? So because in a lot of cases, innocents have been subjected to torture and have passed away in judicial or police custody. And there is also use of extrajudicial forces on the alleged offenders. And when an alleged accused passes away or dies, the case can also be closed. Now let's come to learn about the State Legal Services Authority. First, let us see the Legal Services Authorities Act of 1987, which gives provision to constitute State Legal Services Authority. See, this Act of 1987 was enacted to constitute legal services authorities. The purpose is to provide free and competent legal services to the weaker sections of the society. This is to ensure that opportunities for securing justice were not denied to any citizen by reason of economic or other disabilities. So the Chapter 2 of this Act under Section 3 provides for constitution of National Legal Services Authority at the central level. Then Chapter 3 provides for the constitution of State Legal Services Authority at the level of states. According to Section 6 of this law, every state government shall constitute a body called as State Legal Services Authority so as to exercise the powers and perform the functions conferred on this authority under this Act. See, this state authority should consist of Chief Justice of the High Court, who shall be called as the Patron-in-Chief, then a serving or retired judge of the High Court to be nominated by the Governor of the state in consultation with Chief Justice of the High Court. And this person will serve as the executive chairman. Then it shall have such number of other members who possess experience and qualifications as may be prescribed by the state government. And these members are also to be nominated by the state government in consultation with Chief Justice of the High Court. Now here, the term state government with reference to a union territory refers to the administrator appointed by the president under Article 239 of the Constitution. Now herein let us focus about the functions of the state authority, that is the State Legal Services Authority. See, it gives effect to the policy and directions of National Legal Services Authority. Then it gives legal service to persons who satisfy the criteria that are laid down under this Act. This criteria is given under Section 12 of the law. Under Section 12, the list of eligible persons who can avail free legal services from the legal service authorities is highlighted here. See, it states that every person who has to file or defend a case shall be entitled to the legal services if the person fall under these criteria. Then the State Legal Service Authority shall conduct Lok Adalats, which also includes Lok Adalats for High Court cases as well. Then it shall undertake preventive and strategic legal aid programs. It shall constitute various schemes for different segment of eligible persons. For example, if you take at the national level, NALSA, that is the National Legal Service Authority, has several schemes under this function, like schemes for legal services to disaster victims, then victims of trafficking and commercial sexual exploitation scheme, then effective implementation of poverty alleviation scheme of 2015, then protection and enforcement of tribal rights scheme of 2015, legal services to senior citizen scheme of 2016. So likewise, there are several preventive and strategic legal services schemes, even at the level of states. Then the state authority shall also perform such other functions as the state authority may fix in consultation with the national central authority. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article, wherein we saw about state level legal service authorities. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. Now this news article is about two webinars hosted by an academic institute in collaboration with the Hindu newspaper. They were part of career guidance program. In this regard, let us see some important points mentioned here. This will be a brief discussion on education. You may take few points with reference to mains exam. See, the first webinar focused on higher education in India post COVID-19. Here experts spoke about several ways through which COVID-19 related challenges in education could be combated. They suggested methods like creating a community of learners where students work in teams for their capstone or culmination projects. Herein, this group of students as a team will take ownership of their learning. And they also suggested on assessing students through hackathons, because hackathons will give students a chance to work in teams and to innovate ideas to tackle real-world problems. See, here when we say hackathons, it refers to an event where a lot of people come together so as to write or improve computer programs. Mainly, it consists of element of coming together or teamwork. Then the webinar also emphasized on importance of problem solving. Here, they said the solutions can be achieved through interdisciplinary studies. It then highlighted the multiple career options that are available to students and also stressed on the importance of opting for integrated programs. Now let's come to the second webinar about new age career options after school. See, these are not usual career options. They are new age career options. So the experts during this webinar spoke about multiple job opportunities that are available to students in various fields. You know, the emerging fields like blockchain technology, then in climate change. So these are areas considered as new age career options. We can also say artificial intelligence, machine learning, etc. Then the experts also discussed on technology that is required for constant upskilling, reskilling, and also on the need for students to fine-tune their communication skills. See, communication plays a major role in capturing audience interest or consumer interest in the longer run. In addition, they also advised the students on grooming their listening skills to develop empathy in the society and also to be flexible and to possess the ability to adapt themselves to any challenging situation. The webinar also highlighted the importance of public health or the ability to ensure healthy conditions for the people as a career option. Then even this second webinar also reiterated the need for interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary knowledge, complex problem-solving abilities, having a positive attitude to accept failure, and also on the development of people skills in order to succeed in their career. So these were some of the points that were discussed as mentioned in these two articles. With this, let's move on to next part of the discussion. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. See this question. It reads, with reference to the scheduled tribes in India, consider the following statements. Two statements are given. They are asking which of the statements given above are incorrect. Article 342 of the Constitution empowers the Parliament to exclude communities from the list of scheduled tribes specified by the President. See, this statement is correct. After the first list is released through a public notification by the President, it cannot be subsequently modified by the President, but it can be modified only by the Parliament through an act. Second statement, Hakki, Bikki and Koraga are particularly vulnerable tribal groups from Karnataka. See, the second statement is incorrect. As of now, Jenu, Kuruba and Koraga are the two PVTGs from Karnataka. Hakki Bikki is not a PVTG. Correct answer is option B, two only, because only the second statement is incorrect. Now see this question with reference to Aligarh Muslim University. Two statements are given. Which of the statements given above are correct? The Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College was founded by Mirza Ghulam Ahmed at Aligarh. Later became the Aligarh Muslim University. See, the statement is incorrect because it was founded by Syed Ahmad Khan, not by Mirza Ghulam Ahmed. Mirza Ghulam Ahmed is an Indian Muslim leader who founded Islamic religious movement which was known as Ahmadiyya. So first is incorrect. Second statement, the objective was to build a college in tune with British education system but without compromising its Islamic values. Second statement is correct. So the correct answer is option B, two only. See this question, consider the following statements. Two statements are given. Which of the above statements are correct? The State Legal Services Authority is a constitutional body that provides free and competent legal services to the weaker sections of the society. See, while we have equal justice and free legal aid as part of Article 39 Capital B in Directive Principles of State Policy, the legal services have been provided through legislation by the Parliament. In this case, State Legal Services Authority is constituted under provisions of Legal Services Authorities Act of 1987 and not under Constitution. Therefore, State Legal Services Authority is not a constitutional body but a statutory body. First statement is incorrect. Second statement, the Chief Justice of High Court is the patron in chief of State Legal Services Authority. This statement is correct. Correct answer is option B, two only. Now see this question, which of the following Southeast Asian countries is landlocked? Cambodia, Vietnam, Laos, Myanmar. The correct answer for this question is Laos. The list of mains practice questions are given here for your reference. You may write the answers, upload them as PDF in your drive. In the sharing settings, by right-clicking it, choose anyone with the link and view and post the link in the comment section for peer review. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share, and subscribe to Shankaraya's Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil services exam preparation.